The greatest thing was sacrificing our lives for our country.
When I wear my cap or people can see that I was there, I just let them know it was my turn.
And I think it'll give them an idea of what freedoms we have in this country, because these people paid the price.
The way I see it, I'm still serving my country, but in a new way.
Veterans' Voices. We honor those who serve by sharing stories from the brave men and women who have put their country ahead of themselves. Hello, I'm Kathleen Bade, and this is Veterans Voices, honoring those who serve. Over the next 30 minutes, you'll hear from veterans, young and old, about their time serving our nation. And we begin by hearing from a World War II veteran who recently celebrated his 100th birthday. A retired Army major, Anthony Grant is known for his "not I, but we" mentality. Don Roberts introduces us to this member of the greatest generation.
Hi, I'm doing great. It's a wonderful afternoon.
That positive attitude and a sharp memory have been hallmarks of Mr. Anthony Grant of Hampton. He was 21, living in New York's Harlem Borough.
I was working as a printer's apprentice. Eventually, of course, I became a journalist.
Grant was born in New York, but spent most of his early years in St. Lucia, in the Caribbean. Shortly after returning, he was drafted.
I realized that once I got into the Army, my life would be changed forever.
Grant trained at the Army's Fort Dix, New Jersey, and Fort Lee in Petersburg, Virginia. And that's where he got his first real dose of racism in the armed forces.
So there was a town called Grenada, Mississippi. And I was in the camp near the base for 6 months. And I went in town only twice.
Attitudes in Mississippi were about the same. Grant, like many blacks in World War II, were assigned to the Quartermaster Corps, loading, storing, and delivering supplies to troops on the front lines. And in June of 1944, those front lines were Normandy, France, days after the massive Allied attack known as D-Day.
But within the beach itself, though, it was a complete chaos. Burned equipment.
And as the combat troops pushed forward toward Germany, that's when Grant's troops came under fire.
I've been shot at, and I in turn have shot my weapon.
After the war, Grant moved up the ranks in the Quartermaster Corps while serving all over Europe, Korea, and Japan. He retired after 20 years with the rank of major in 1963.
You've reached the ripe age of 100. Do you have a secret for longevity?
Have a positive mind. Have a positive mind. Things will get better tomorrow.
For Veterans Voices, I'm Don Roberts.
A small prayer book played a big role in the life of another World War II hero. Edmund Sternot received it during his confirmation into the Catholic Church as a child. Eddie, as his friends and family called him, took it with him to Europe when he was called into action during World War II. Sternot was killed during the Battle of the Bulge in 1945. While his body was removed from the field where he died, that book stayed until it was found years later. And several decades after that, it found its way to an Army veteran in Colorado who learned something special about its owner. Sternot earned a Silver Star for heroism just days before his death, but the award was never given to him or his family.
That medal had never been presented to the family, that the family actually never knew officially what he had done on the battlefield. That created an entirely different chapter to this, which only recently was concluded.
It's wonderful, and I'm glad he finally got his due justice.
That's Sternot's only living family member, a cousin named Dolores, who was on hand last Veterans Day as the war hero was finally honored with a Silver Star, along with a Bronze Star and a Purple Heart. Dolores says she is proud of her cousin's service and thankful for the veteran who helped write the final chapter of his story. On the other side of the world, during that war, secret soldiers from the Navajo Nation in Arizona and New Mexico played key roles in leading the Allied forces to victory. David Romero highlights some of the Native Americans behind the Code Talkers program.
The greatest thing was sacrificing our lives for our country. It wasn't just a duty, it was a responsibility. And we knew that we had to defeat the enemy, or they would defeat all of us, take what we had.
Roy Hawthorne and more than 400 fellow co-talkers volunteered from both sides of the state border inside the Navajo Nation of New Mexico and Arizona. Now, the idea to use the Navajo language as a communications code in the Pacific Theater came from a military man who once lived on the reservation. He knew the Navajo language was incredibly complex and only known by a small group of people. Young Navajo men were recruited, and this was to create the code using common names in their language to describe the military terms like battleships, tanks, and reconnaissance planes.
It's quiet, doesn't carry any armament. That's a hummingbird. In Navajo, it was Dakitin.
In battles across the Pacific, code talkers would relay thousands of messages with no errors, and their code would never be broken by the Japanese. Hawthorne and the others had used their language as a successful weapon, a native language that was ironically often prohibited in reservation boarding schools at home.
The language was discouraged. The use of it was discouraged.
The role of the code talkers in the war was kept secret for decades. Only much later were they acknowledged and their story fully told. Hawthorne says despite the hardships his native people had endured on American reservations, when the war came, frustrations were set aside.
We were loyal to our country. It wasn't because it was called America, but it was called a people that were willing to do for other people. That's the way we treated one another.
Roy Hawthorne passed away in 2018. Very few of the original 400 code talkers are alive today, and there's a big push in New Mexico to create a museum to honor these heroes. Last year, the New Mexico legislature and the governor pledged more than $1 million to start construction of the museum. For Veterans Voices, I'm David Romero.
Still to come on Veterans Voices, the author hoping to share the stories of thousands of our troops who died in the line of duty. And
this is probably the most meaningful work that I've done in my career.
Looking right at the lens here.
Nothing kind of compares with leaving something that, you know, has a legacy and has an impact that this kind of work does. Okay.
Photos worth well more than 1,000 words. The photographer behind a one-of-a-kind project. Plus, the important role service dogs play in the recovery of our wounded warriors.
We now return to Veterans Voices, honoring those who serve.
Welcome back to Fox 5's Veteran Voices, honoring those who serve. It's been said that every picture tells a story, and it's that concept inspiring one photographer to travel the nation so veterans can share theirs. Jeremy Hubbard with the details on his mission.
All I remember was like getting hit in the head with a baseball bat.
When you've taken a bullet to the helmet like Bill Purcell has,
you got nailed down.
Your story has to be told.
February 1st, 1968, Way City.
Truth is, this entire room is full of Marines and sailors with unforgettable stories.
Here we go, right here. 1, 2, 3.
And a veterans charity is making sure they don't go untold any longer.
Just looking right at the camera.
John Reedy is a photographer for the Greatest Generations Foundation, a nonprofit aimed at preserving the history of American heroes.
Looking right to me. There we go.
The charity has been gathering groups of Vietnam and Korean War vets like this all over the country for portrait sessions.
This is probably the most meaningful work that I've done in my career.
Looking right at the lens here.
Nothing kind of compares with leaving something that, you know, has a legacy and has an impact that this kind of work does.
It is a rare moment to shine for veterans who have never sought the spotlight before.
I was in Korea from all of 1952.
Men like 88-year-old Ted Gembinski of Colorado Springs, Colorado, who fought on the cold battlefields of Korea, the so-called Forgotten War.
When I wear my cap or people can see that I was there, I just let them know it was my turn.
Some of these men spent decades in the service. Some did more than one tour on the battlefield.
I'm just looking right at the camera. Yeah. Perfect.
Their portraits will be made into a commemorative photo book alongside 70 other Korean War vets from all over the country and more than 50 Vietnam vets. The books will be given to schools and museums nationwide so future generations can learn about their place in our past and how to hopefully keep what happened to them from ever happening again.
History repeats itself.
For Veterans Voices, I'm Jeremy Hubbard.
Still to come on Veterans Voices, a wounded warrior thriving as an athlete. 27 surgeries after she was injured in an airstrike. Plus,
there's no reason in the year 2020 why we can't have grave sites that are more than just names on stone.
An author out to share the story of every U.S. service member killed during the Second World War.
Now return to Veterans Voices, honoring those who serve.
Welcome back to Veterans Voices, honoring those who serve. More than 400,000 American service members died while serving our country during World War II. Now one man wants to put all of their stories down on paper. Jeremy Hubbard shows us how he hopes to keep their voices as loud as ever.
We see a field of heroes who served their country. But Don Milne,
when you look at his date of death, it says June 5th, 1943.
Right here, he sees thousands of stories desperate to be told.
So Everett Burkholz here was actually born in Colorado.
And he wants to tell as many of them as possible.
So they put him on a Belgian liner. It was called the SS Leopoldville.
Milne lives in Utah, but visited Denver's Fort Logan National Cemetery as part of his new project, Stories Behind the Stars.
His location on the ship, he probably was killed by the torpedo.
He spent the last 3 years researching and writing about the fallen heroes of World War II.
Just because it was an accident doesn't mean that we shouldn't remember people like Everett.
His goal is to compile short histories of each of the 400,000 plus American service members killed in that war.
I got into this because I started just as a hobby, because my kids are older and I have some free time. Every day I would write the story of someone who died during World War II, and I wrote more than 1,200 of those stories between the 75th anniversary of the end of Pearl Harbor and the 75th anniversary of the signing of the peace with Japan on the battleship Missouri.
In the end, he wants to create a searchable database, even a smartphone app, so users could visit a place like this, scan a name on a headstone.
Yep, that's his story, and we've had it all written here, so someone could read it while they're visiting his gravesite.
And be taken straight to a webpage that tells the soldier's story.
And I think it'll give them an idea of what freedoms we have in this country, because these people paid the price.
It isn't going to be easy. So far, he's only compiled about 1,200 profiles.
Looking for the grave of Harry Nelson.
So he's enlisting help researching these enlisted men and women.
His plane actually ditched in the ocean, so this is a cenotaph grave. He's not actually here.
He wants family members and friends to submit stories about their heroes who died, and volunteers to help write about these historic men and women.
They just visit grave sites, find a name of someone who died in World War II, and write their story. It only takes an hour or two to write a story. We give you free access to research sites like Ancestry, newspapers, Full 3. And if you can write an obituary, you can do one of these stories.
Already, people from all over the country and all over the world have offered to take part.
We don't have a lot of professional genealogists, historians that are helping us out. It's mostly just people that have some free time. They have a love for those who serve our country. They want to see their stories remembered. And so they're writing these stories. It's amazing.
His objective may seem ambitious, overwhelming, and impossible.
His story is he was in the 66th Infantry Division.
But compared to the goal these heroes fought for in faraway lands more than 75 years ago, it's the least he can do.
There's no reason in the year 2020 why we can't have grave sites that are more than just names on stone.
For Veterans Voices, I'm Jeremy Hubbard.
Now to the story of a wounded warrior with a spirit that can survive anything. Monica Southall was hurt during an airstrike in Afghanistan back in 2009. Always an athlete, she committed herself to competition as she recovered. Southall has since earned 5 gold medals in the Warrior and Invictus Games, taking part in seated volleyball, discus, and shot put. She even scored a snapshot with Prince Harry. Southall says nothing about her 27 surgeries has dampened her spirit.
Sometimes you need an outlet, or you need something to, a reason to get up. And the games to me were a reason to get up every morning and train hard and just try and do my best, you know, to compete, not only in life, but at the games as well. I love giving back. I love being able to show other soldiers what I've learned through the games and what I've experienced and what I've been through, and also just pass on anything that I've learned as a soldier medically as well.
Southall is now giving back to other veterans as a coach, paying it forward to other wounded servicemen and servicewomen, striving to keep their own competitive spirits alive. That veteran, one of countless others who have returned home to face major physical or mental challenges, Constance Jones, with how service dogs are helping many of them get their lives back on track.
Daddy? Daddy, watch me. Okay, let's go. Girl. This is Dottie. She is 19 months old and she is a black lab. She's been paired with me.
After 7 years in the Army, Michelle went back to civilian life, but it wasn't easy.
For me, basically, it is climbing Mount Everest every time I leave my house.
Michelle was having trouble going out in public. Eventually, she was diagnosed with post-traumatic stress disorder.
Simple task for person without PTSD, I should say, is something that I cannot do. For example, going to the grocery store is a task I'm not able to do. I'm not able to go to Target. Walmart, forget it.
Like many veterans, she's gone through a list of treatments and therapies to no avail until she learned about Service Dogs of Virginia, located in Charlottesville.
My hope for having Dottie is that I am finally able to return to a normal life again, that I am able to have a sense of normalcy back in my life. Girl, let's go.
But getting a dog like Dottie is easier said than done. It cost approximately $40,000 over a 2-year period to raise, train, and place a successful service dog with a person in need. Sally Day serves as the director of development at Service Dogs of Virginia.
I do everything I can to raise funds. We do not pass on that cost to our clients. I write grants. We have individual donors. I get corporate sponsorships.
Since 2000, the organization has placed over 95 dogs with clients throughout Virginia.
How do you guys go about placement? How do you, I imagine there's a long list of people who are needing assistance.
When service dog organizations began, they all started with a waiting list because there was so much need. Essentially, we're trying to meet the need that's out there, and that's why we have grown.
Today was day two of transfer camp for the dogs and the new owners. It's a little different than in years past with social distancing and mask wearing. Each dog here is being paired for different clients with different needs.
Go in.
Michelle, excited about her new relationship. In 2 weeks, they'll be out on their own.
This is just a tool for me to carry around with me. This is going to be like having my best friend with me wherever I go.
She hopes by sharing her story, other veterans will be inspired.
I think it's extremely important. Not all wounds are visible.
Knowing that it's okay to ask for a helping hand or paw to guide them through a difficult time.
I would encourage them to reach out, seek the help. Nobody's going to look at you differently.
For Veterans Voices, I'm Constance Jones.
Coming up on Veterans Voices, we'll introduce you to the company that calls itself the Amazon of military care packages.
Return to Veterans Voices, honoring those who serve.
Veterans Voices continues now with the story of a former Navy journalist who saw a very specific need while she was visiting our troops overseas. When her time serving our nation ended, she decided to help our soldiers in a different way. And as Katie Collette explains, her cause is one all of us can support.
For many service members and their families, Troopster is their lifeline to each other.
We are essentially the Amazon of military care packages.
The idea for the nonprofit sparked in Second Class Petty Officer Chelsea Mandello's mind while serving in the Mediterranean during sequestration, a time of military budget cuts and extended deployments.
I remember we hadn't received mail in 3 months. And yes, and finally we were receiving this large shipment of care packages.
Chelsea's mom sent her a giant care package, but
everything in it had gone bad. Things had broken, things had melted.
So when 7 years of service and world travels with the Navy ended with an honorable discharge, Chelsea launched Troopster in November of 2015. Everyone who works there is a veteran.
We're all service members who have been deployed, who know what these active duty members are going through, and it means a lot to us personally.
This veteran says Troopster guarantees products will arrive in great condition to active duty service members anywhere in the world. And those serving without a family support system?
We actually travel across the nation where we work with different businesses and local organizations to hold community-wide PAC events. And so those PAC events, we work with these sponsors to send anywhere between 500 to 2,000 care packages, often to troops who don't have that family support network.
Chelsea makes it clear, just because her time in the Navy has ended does not mean her service has.
Now, the way I see it, I'm still serving my country, but in a new way.
For Veterans Voices, I'm Katie Collette.
Thank you for joining us as Fox 5 shares these important stories. We send our sincerest gratitude to all who have served this country. And you can find these stories and much more on our website at fox5sandiego.com. For Veterans Voices, I'm Kathleen Bade.